In December, a man named Tommy Calloway was charged with sexual battery for slapping reporter Alex Bozargian on the bottom during a live broadcast. Bozargian was covering a Savannah 5K run when Calloway, on camera, pulled himself out of the crowd of runners, ran towards Bozargian, and slapped her on the butt. Bozargian later said she felt, quote, violated by the incident. Calloway, who is, by the way, a youth minister, Boy Scout leader, and father of two, because of course he is, has rightly been charged with sexual battery. In Georgia, as in other parts of the United States, non-consensually slapping another human on the ass is sexual battery. With one kinda big exception. We're gonna get to that. In his defense, Calloway's attorney released a statement saying, quote, while we regret the situation, Mr. Calloway did not act with any criminal intentions. Tommy is a loving husband and father who is very active in his community. So don't worry, guys. He didn't intend to commit sexual battery. Calloway's defense is super familiar to me. It's the same exact argument slap happy parents deliver unto my inbox every goddamn week, that their intentions are good. So, when it comes to spanking, does intent matter? In conversations about criminal behavior, some people argue that intent really is a game changer. And I can see where they're coming from. Think about the difference between murder and euthanasia, for example. Everyone agrees that killing someone with malicious intent is murder, obviously. But most people think there are situations where a person can kill another person with benign or even benevolent intent. I'm thinking now of administering euthanasia to someone who is suffering from a terminal illness. And I do believe that euthanasia is different than murder. By this logic, I actually can see where the people who use intent as a defense of child abuse are coming from. In theory, a parent could spank a child with all kinds of cutesy benevolent intentions, like the intent to teach or the intent to discipline, just like it's possible to kill another person with benevolent intent. People who commit acts of domestic violence just love to whine about their intentions. Here are just a few examples I was able to find in like 5 seconds on my phone in the Nairobi Airport departure lounge. In New York City, when 75-year-old Noor Hussein beat his wife to death because she served him lentils for dinner, defense attorney Julie Clark argued that Hussein should be given a more lenient sentence because he, quote, didn't intend to kill her. In 2014, when NFL player Adrian Peterson left bleeding welts on his son's butt, thighs, and scrotum, he told police officers, quote, to be honest with you, I feel very confident with my actions because I know my intent. Later he said, I am someone that disciplined his child and did not intend to cause him any injury. Sometimes this whiny bullshit about intent even works. In 2015, a California Superior Court judge dramatically reduced the sentence of 20-year-old Kevin Jonas Rojano Nieto, who had been convicted of sodomizing and sexually abusing a 3-year-old girl, because Rojano Nieto did not, quote, intend to harm the victim. In the country where I live, Kenya, a 40-year-old mother admitted beating her son to death with a stick, but she said she didn't intend to kill. So she was given a sentence of only 1 year probation. This is all very familiar to me. As one polo shirt in my inbox argued after one of my many widely ignored articles about why parents should keep their hands the fuck off their kids' butts, quote, I am not worried about my daughters feeling sexually violated by spankings because I know I don't intend anything sexual by it. But wait. Is intent really the game changer here? Is intent really the difference between murder and euthanasia? Is intent really the difference between sexual battery and discipline? No, it's not. Because if some dude were to go around town putting people out of their misery without their permission, it really doesn't matter what his intentions are. That dude is a murderer. The difference between murder and euthanasia is not intent. it's consent. And the same goes for domestic violence. Why do people, like, always forget about consent? So, back to Tommy Calloway and Alex Bazargian. Regardless of what Calloway says about his benign intent, the Chatham County Sheriff's Office says this incident is legal sexual battery. And most people, including me, agree. Non-consensually slapping a person on the ass is sexual battery, punishable with up to 1 year of prison in Georgia. Unless, of course, you do it habitually, ritualistically, and repeatedly to your child. In that case, sexual battery is just old-fashioned parenting. This makes no fucking sense. According to Georgia law, and according to the law in every other state, by the way, sexual battery basically stops being sexual battery if your victim is your child. Or, in Georgia and many other US states, your student. I don't want to minimize the violation that Bazargian experienced here. It was horrible, and no person deserves to be treated that way. But what can legally happen to children in the United States is literally the exact same thing, but worse. Like, okay, when I watch footage of this incident of sexual battery, and I think about what parents can legally do to their children in the United States, when I think about what my mother was able to legally do to me, I mean, it's the exact same thing, just with the kind of significant additions of nudity and bruises. Like, I feel like I'm taking crazy pills. People use the fantasy of intent to justify this double standard. Even if I were to proceed from the assumption that parents really do spank their children with good intentions, and, you know, not just because they're tired, frustrated, angry, drunk, having a bad day, or at the end of their tether, the idea that good intentions transform what the law already recognizes as sexual battery into an acceptable parenting choice is as incomprehensible to me as the idea that good intentions could transform non-consensual euthanasia into an acceptable medical choice. I mean, like, does anyone else think this is crazy? Tommy Calloway's intent is irrelevant. I truly don't care what was going through his head. The bottom line is, he slapped a woman on a sexual body part without her permission. That's why it's sexual battery. And I just happen to be of the super radical opinion that his crime would still be his crime if his victim were his daughter or his student. Sexual battery doesn't stop being sexual battery just because your victim is your child. Some people, even people who really support me, start to feel weird when I talk this way. And I do understand why. Despite how good white people are at hiding it, studies show that a majority of American parents still believe it is at least sometimes appropriate to spank a child. Most people watching this video were probably spanked as kids. I was too. It can be really hard to acknowledge the ways in which our parents messed up, but it's necessary. I'm going to kick it over to Chris Carter, who delivered one of the most courageous public condemnations of state-sanctioned child battery I have ever seen on a major platform.
This is the thing, and this goes across all racial lines, ethnicities, religious backgrounds. People believe in discipline in their children. People with any type of Christian background, they really believe in disciplining their children. My mom did the best job she could do, raising seven kids by herself. But there are thousands of things that I have learned since then that my mom was wrong.
Yes. Thank you.
It's the 21st century. My mom was wrong. She did the best she could, but she was wrong about some of that stuff she taught me. And I promise my kids I won't teach that mess to them. You can't be the kid to make them do what they want
That's
to do.
That's correct. Mm-hmm.
It's possible to acknowledge that many of our parents did something wrong, regardless of whatever their intentions were, and still love them. It's possible to acknowledge that sexual battery is sexual battery, whether it happens to a reporter or to a child, without needing to be totally traumatized by our own memories. In fact, finding the right words to describe what happened to me really helped me sort out all kinds of shit.
I'm fine. I'm totally fine. Can't you tell I'm fine?
And it's possible to press for cultural and even legal change without feeding into the carceral state that unfairly tortures millions of Americans in prison. When Sweden first criminalized child battery way back in 1979, the rate of child abuse prosecutions did not increase. This can be done. We just need to wake up and realize that these women deserve the same protections as this woman. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Sexual battery doesn't stop being sexual battery just because your victim is your child.